to know more such amazing stories from Indian history, click the bell icon and subscribe to Live History India.
It was 5:30 p.m. on Sunday, the 13th of April, 1919. In an enclosed ground not far from Sikhism's holiest shrine, the Golden Temple in Amritsar, several thousand people were celebrating the spring festival of Baisakhi and had also gathered in non-violent protest against the British. Then soldiers arrived and blocked the exits. Without warning, 50 soldiers fired continuously for more than 10 minutes, firing 1,650 bullets. An estimated 1,500 people, men, women and children, were killed and injured in that killing field called Jallianwala Bagh. Among the dead was an infant. The perpetrator of the massacre was Brigadier General Reginald Dyer. It shook India and Britain as nothing had until then, even with the great many colonial cruelties, from extreme taxation and killings to the triggering of massive famines. And there were repercussions, from symbolic to seismic. The Nobel laureate Rabindranath Tagore returned his knighthood in protest. The bloodbath turned Mohandas Gandhi into a fierce critic of the empire and an unrelenting campaigner against it, and triggered his non-cooperation movement in 1920. One British paper, The Star, wrote of the Jallianwala Bagh massacre, "It is the darkest stain on British rule in India." India in the 1910s was a land in churn. The ideas of nationalism and Swadeshi had swept the subcontinent. World War I had brought a temporary truce between Indian nationalists and colonial Britain to fight the Germany-led Axis powers, but the war's end had brought more disappointment, resentment, and anger. Britain dismissed any talk of independence and initiated weak political reforms. Returning Indian troops brought stories of discrimination on the basis of pay, race, and caste. The Spanish flu arrived too, ultimately killing 5% of India's population. Meanwhile, revolutionaries in Bengal and Punjab, those of the Ghadar movement, had continued their activities throughout the war. A combination of the exigencies of war and the need to contain revolutionary activities led the government to legislate the Defence of India Act of 1915. It allowed preventive detention, imprisonment without trial, and massive curbing of the freedom of speech and expression critical of Britain. The government soon passed another repressive legislation, the Anarchical and Revolutionary Crimes Act of 1919, popularly known as the Rowlatt Act, after its architect, Sidney Rowlatt. It made provisions of the 1915 legislation more stringent. Protests erupted. For Punjab, it was the tipping point. The province was already reeling under a repressive regime of the governor of Punjab, Michael O'Dwyer, in which taxes had increased and the price of food grain had rocketed. Even Amritsar's businessmen called for strikes in early April 1919. Dr. Satyapal and Dr. Saifuddin Kichlu, both Congress leaders from Amritsar, had begun to forge communal unity in the city. Their arrest on 10th April further inflamed the public. 24 were killed in retaliatory firing by the police. Violence began to be directed at Britishers, including a lady. That brought further clampdown, including making Indians who took the street where the lady was attacked crawl on their bellies. Even so, the gathering at Jallianwala Bagh on 13th April, in defiance of a ban on public gatherings, was non-violent. Reginald Dyer arrived with his mix of troops from the Gurkha, Sikh and Sindh regiments. the massacre ensued. The subsequent imposition of martial law in Punjab led to more repression and more atrocities. And a subsequent inquiry by the Government of India did little to address justice. The Disorders Inquiry Committee of 1919-20, which came to be known as the Hunter Commission after its chairman, William Hunter, was largely a whitewash for the empire. Indeed, General Dyer's testimony to the commission was particularly chilling. He said, "I considered it my duty to fire on them and to fire well." To a query, supposing the passage was sufficient to allow the armored cars to go in, would you have opened fire with the machine guns? Dyer replied, "I think probably, yes." Dyer escaped with an admonition, blocking of further promotion, eventual return to Britain, and an uneventful death in 1927. But Governor O'Dwyer paid a blood price. On 13th of March 1940, Udham Singh, a revolutionary, shot and killed O'Dwyer in London. At his trial, Udham Singh marked O'Dwyer as the real culprit of the Jallianwala Bagh massacre. Udham Singh was hanged on 31st July 1940. He is remembered in India today as a martyr to the cause of India's independence, as are the women, men, and children who died in Jallianwala Bagh.